Om Asato Ma Sadgamaya Tamaso Ma Jyotirgamaya Mrityor Ma Amritangamaya Om Shanti 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 Hare Om Om Prapanna Parijataya Totra Vetraika Panaye Gnana Mudraya Krishnaya Gita Amrita Duhe Namaha Sarvopanishado Gavo Dogdha Gopala Nandanaha Patho Vatsa Sudhir Bhokta Dugdham Gitamritam Mahat Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kamsachanuramardhanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagat Gurum Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangum Langhayate Girim Yatkripatamaham Vande Paramanandamadhavam.
We are discussing the second chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. The Lord is condemning the first part of the Vedas, which is full of Vedic rituals. The doubts will come that why the Lord condemning Veda? Who was the author of the Vedas? The Lord. The Lord, actually nobody. The thing is, knowledge cannot have any creation. You don't create knowledge. Knowledge is eternal. Discovery of knowledge is what we call rishis. That is why they are called mantra drashtas. Mantra means truth. They are the what you call discoverers, uncoverers of truth, not inventors of the truth. So these rishis, they got all the knowledge only from God. And what is the knowledge? About God. And God is eternal. And if any object is there, the object and its knowledge, they always go together. Can you ever imagine an object and say that there is no knowledge part of it? Can you imagine a table without the knowledge of the table? So that nama and rupa, the name, the form, and what it is particularly, and how we distinguish it from everything else is called knowledge. Therefore, the Lord only created Vedas. Created means manifested. Because creation is eternal and knowledge is also eternal. Therefore, you can only say manifestation at a particular point of view. How you know? When you go to sleep, you are not there. Therefore, there is no knowledge. But as soon as you wake up, the moment you wake up, knowledge also comes at the same time. Now, what is the point here we are discussing? That the Lord himself promulgated the Vedas. And the Lord is condemning, seemed to be condemning. No, he is not really condemning. This was the point we discussed in our last Gita class. Then why was the Lord telling? He is condemning. But for whom? You see, if you are a teacher and there is a student who is in the college, would you condemn ABCDs? But if that person still cannot give up his ABCD books, then you will condemn him. You are in the college. Why do you want it? Because it has served its purpose. You don't need to go back to that again. You see, you get the point? For those who are attached to this world, the first part of the Vedas called Karma Kanda or Dharma Kanda is relevant. Why? What does the first part do? It will fulfill any desire in this world through the Karma Kanda. Now, when we say a person is a believer and a person is a non-believer, according to Hindu Dharma, a person who believes the Vedas is called Astika. A person who doesn't believe in the Vedas is called Nastika. So the Vedas are very valid. Any type of desire a person wants, what we call dharma, artha and kama. These three fall under the domain of the first part of the Vedas called Karma Kanda, but not moksha, because moksha means you have to go beyond dharma, beyond artha, beyond kama. And why you need to go and how you need to go is the subject which we will come shortly. But the point here is, O Arjuna, you claim to be a spiritual aspirant. Who is a spiritual aspirant? A spiritual aspirant is a person who had enjoyed this world to his heart's content and now who has no more desire for it. And he discovered there is something beyond this world. Which is beyond this world? What is there? There are only two entities in this whole cosmos. One is the world. Other than the world, what is there? Only God. God and world. Choose. What do you want? Do you want the world or do you want God? Is it ever possible that a person can throw out God and only choose the world? What it means is that do you want your worldly enjoyment through God, or you don't want any worldly enjoyment but exclusively want only God? Who is a spiritual aspirant? He who says, I don't want anything in this world, I want only God. That is the type of person Arjuna claims to be. For him, he says, you don't need to even think about Karma Kanda. Why is he telling? Because Karma Kanda is very tempting. Maya. What is the whole Karma Kanda? Is nothing but Maya. And do you know what is Maya? Here is most marvelous thing for us to learn. We say, there is so many things in this world. There are not so many things in this world. There are only two things, my body and my mind. In your deep sleep, the world disappears. When are you aware of the world? Only when you are awake or when you are dreaming. Now, our body, our mind is what we should strictly call our world. There is nothing else outside this. How are you seeing me? Through your body or outside your body? How are you looking at me? Are you looking at me? You are looking at me as though outside you. But in fact, you are looking at me as what? Inside your mind. Don't you understand this? The whole world is in our mind. Okay, we will come to that point. Very important point. When you are dreaming, where is the world? Only in the mind. But when will you understand that there is no world outside, but it is all in my mind? When will you understand it? When you are dreaming, do you call it a dream or waking state? When you are dreaming, it is not a dreaming state. It is a waking state. And waking state becomes a dream state. So you may be in the waking state in your house, but in your dream you may be in Chennai. Is it not? So in Chennai, you wake up from your dream, in the dream. And somebody asks, where were you? Very interesting, a little complex. You are here, you dream that you are in Chennai. And in Chennai, you are tired and you go to bed, all in dream. And in that dream, in the dream, you are imagining you are in UK. And when you wake up in your dream, and then someone in the dream asks you, what were you dreaming about? Oh, I was dreaming I was in UK. What a foolish person. I am really in Chennai. And then you wake up. Where are you now? Is it true? In dreams also you can have a dream. What is the point here? When we are in dreaming state, are we dreaming? Are we thinking that the world is inside or outside? It's both. We say that, you know, when you are in a house, and when somebody knocks at your door in your dream, what you say, I am inside the house, somebody is outside the house, that somebody outside the house is knocking the door, asking for admission into the house. Is it not? You are using that word in and out. That is my point. There also you are using the word in and out. But when you wake up, when you come to the so-called waking state and recollect that dream, then is that person outside, inside or outside? Do you get what I am saying? In the person in your dream who is knocking, is he inside your mind or outside your mind? Now, we think because that is a dream, Everything is inside our mind. But this is called waking state. In this waking state, we make exactly the same observations. We are in this room, somebody is outside this room. Is it not? How do you know that this is not also in our mind? That is my point. It is the whole world is in our mind. This is not philosophy. This is what happens every second of our life. How do we know? You know a little bit of psychology. Your eyes, for example, act like a camera, take my picture in and presents it on the screen of your mind. That is how you perceive. My physical form, my voice, etc. You are not seeing outside, but you are seeing inside. The consequences are terrible. What is so terrible? Because if you ask me what time you are seeing me, if you put a milliseconds stopwatch, there is a gap between your eyesight alighting upon me and this information going inside you, and you recognize this is so and so, there is a perceptible gap is there. We discussed in our past, you can see some stars. How do you know? Because the light has just reached. But that star might have been dead long back. Anyway, what is my point here? Let us not lose the point. What is the point here? None of us are experiencing the world outside. It appears as though it is outside, but actually we are experiencing it inside our mind. Like you are sitting in front of a TV screen and you are watching a game, for example, which is really taking place. Where are you seeing it? In the TV. But when you are looking at the TV also, where are you really looking at it? The mind becomes your TV, and you, the jiva, sits in front of that TV and see. Is it a fact? Is it a point you understood? Apart from your idea of in your mind, I am talking about psychology. Now you are seeing me, isn't it? So where are you seeing me? Am I outside or inside you? If without eyes, how do you know that I am here? My impression is taken through your eyes. That's the most important point. I will tell you why also. You are not really looking at me. Do all of you? The illusion is there is someone sitting outside. That idea of outside and inside is an idea inside our mind actually. Really speaking, you are not looking at me outside. There is something outside. There is no zero. But that something you are not looking exactly. Your eye is taking. Supposing you have got cataract or the jaundice. How do I appear to you? Am I yellow? Actually, it is your problem, not my problem. Like the fellow, one fellow, he had a double vision. He went to an ophthalmologist. And the ophthalmologist asked, what is the problem? The fellow said, doctor, I see everything as two. For example, I see you two doctors. The doctor said, what, all three of you have the same problem? Get the point correctly. What is the point here? We never see anything as it is outside. That's why this, you know, when you are looking through a camera, imagine there is from the camera you are looking. You are looking directly to the object, or are you looking what the camera presents you? That's what is happening now. This is a simple fact. This is not philosophy, imagination. When you hear, some sound is going inside you. And if you don't know that sound, you will not understand. You only think there is some sound. To understand this sound, you must understand what language I am speaking. If I speak in Chinese, will you understand what I am talking? Because you can hear the sound, but you don't have the interpretive skill. We never have any knowledge what is outside. We get the knowledge through our eyes, through our ears, through our nose, through our tongue, and through our skin. Now this is, as it is, not a big problem. The problem comes. We each have an idea, preconceived idea about every person. And that is what we apply, that filter we apply. I like this person. When do you say I like this person? Before applying this filter or after applying the filter? Nobody ever sees the world exactly alike. That is the point. A mother sees her child in one way. A father sees in another way. A neighbor sees in a totally different way. A tiger sees in a totally different way. That is to illustrate the point. Nobody sees the same thing exactly alike. So what is the lesson? What we call the world doesn't exist outside our body. It is within. The body is only like a camera. Imagine a video with five faculties. Normally, video camera has got only two faculties. It can record sight and sound. But our mind has got the five: sight, sound, smell, taste, and touch. It constantly, these five sense organs are recording the knowledge and giving it, presenting it in front of the mind. And in front of the mind acts like a screen. And in front of that mind screen, buddhi is sitting. Buddhi. Another faculty of the, what we call antahkarana. And that is experiencing. Once it experiences, this is so and so. For example, this is Swami Dayatmananda. Then it decides, I like, I don't like, I understand, I don't understand. This is tough, this is easy. All these things follow as a reaction. First, experience, then our interpretation. Third, how we like or not. This is how every millisecond our experience is going on. The only time we don't experience is only in deep sleep. There is, you don't know what is outside, excepting what your sense organs presented to you. That's why sometimes we mistake also many things. What is the whole point now we are coming? Why did I bring this subject? If we are attracted to the world, then the first part of the Veda, it has that the means to fulfill our desires. Now, very important point again I want to convey to you. There is somebody, he's a young man, he wants to get knowledge, he wants to be married, he wants to have children, he wants to have wealth, he wants to have name and fame, he wants to live a long life. If you ask any doctor, any psychologist, what if with this bucket list, he goes and says, what shall I do? What would be is, you have to go to a educational institution, get good education, get good job, then go and find out a suitable spouse, and then get married, have children, try to have children, and this is, you work hard and be skillfully, and then your name and fame will come, etc., etc. But if you go and ask Veda, Veda means any teacher who teaches Veda, he says, if you want knowledge, pray to Mother Saraswati. If you want wealth, pray to Mother Lakshmi. If you want success, pray to Kartikeya. If you want all the vignas to be removed, obstructions to be removed, pray to Ganesha. For everything, is it possible? Do you believe in it? That is called Astikya. Do you believe in it? That is the truth. That is the truth. Because how it is, even if you go to school or college, who is bestowing the grace? Only God, in the form of Mother Saraswati. Suppose you take a donkey to a school or college. Do you think it is going to get your MA, PhD and all those things? Not going to get. What is my point? There are people, for example, Kalidasa. How did he become the world-renowned poet? Grace of the Mother. So, the whole point we are discussing is, the first part of the Vedas called Karma Kanda. It is by the, I'll never forget. Karma Kanda means not only, it is action related, Dharma Kanda. And it will never teach us adharma. That is why religion itself is called dharma. Hindu dharma we call it. Christav dharma, Islam dharma. Dharma means a way of righteous living, believing in God. If we want anything in this world related to dharma, artha and kama, the first part of the Vedas is our greatest guideline. That means dharma, artha, kama belong to what? The whole world is comprised in these three words. Dharma, artha and kama. But if someone says, by experience, I see the whole lot always changing, because we discussed anything in this world changes. If daytime changes, what time does it become?
Night.
If happiness changes, what does it become? Unhappy. If life changes, what does it become? Death. If death changes, what happens? That part we don't know. Because that part we have to know only from the Vedas. Jatasya hi dhruvor mrutyu dhruvam janma mritasya cha. That we don't know, that something is dead, is coming back to life. That also I can tell. Yes, you can say that. Suppose, for example, somebody is fond of fish. What does he do? He eats fish. Now, does he eat dead fish or live fish? The moment you eat any living thing, it becomes dead, isn't it? But the moment you digest that, what is happening now? That dead fish is regenerated into every part of ourself. Is it not a fact? That is how we are sustaining. So in a way you can say, dead thing is coming alive and live thing is becoming dead. Anything, your potato, is it live or dead before you eat it? It is live. Then when you boil, what happens? When you eat it and digest it, digestion means, you know what it is? It becomes you. This is a process we can understand. But human beings, you know, we don't know there is rebirth. That is where the scriptures come in. Who is a spiritual person? I don't want anything related to this world. That means what? What is he telling? I don't want anything to do with the body and mind. Therefore, what is there beyond body and mind? If you exclude from our life body and mind, what remains? Only one thing remains, which is called God, pure consciousness. That is why every human being or every living being, but human being, is trichotomous in its personality. Trichotomous means three. Dichotomous means what?
Two.
Trichotomous means what? Three. Three means what? Body, mind and Atma. That is it. Otherwise you have to call it Achetana, Achit. Chit means three. Ishvara, Chit. Chit means living. Living means Jiva. Jiva means body, mind plus a bit of God, which is called pure consciousness. And that means Sat, Chit and Ananda. If I don't want world, that means I want God. Such a person is called spiritual aspirant. For such a person, the Lord is condemning and saying, if you want spirituality, you have to go beyond your body and mind. Or to put it in logical language, if you want the unlimited, you have to give up the limited. What is the limited? Body and mind. The point I want to emphasize again and again, there is nothing outside excepting our body and mind. If there is something, we don't know anything about it. We know everything as body and mind only. What comes inside? That is an important point. You don't know what the table is outside, but you think it is a table. For such people, the Lord is telling. And he tells something most important according to Vedanta principles. What is it? The whole universe. World means what? I said body and mind. And body and mind are consisting of only three things, called three gunas, sattva, rajas, tamas. The English word nature is translated into Sanskrit, called prakriti. And prakriti is consisting of what? Sattva guna, rajo guna and tamo guna. Whether it is an object outside, whether it is our body, whether it is our mind, our body, mind is not outside the world, mind you. We think, I am this and the world is something. But supposing, I think, you are part of the world. But what do you think about me? I am the part of the world. You don't say that Swami is apart from the world, and world is apart from Swami, and you are apart from both Swami and world. You don't see three things. You see only three things. Your individuality, the world and God. We include everybody in this world. And the funniest thing is, everybody includes everybody else in the world and thinks they are something very special, individual, and everybody else is included in what they call world. According to Vedanta, all bodies, all minds are included in the world. The world is consisting of three gunas. The whole universe is consisting of three gunas. Everything is manifestation of three gunas in different proportions. That is what makes the difference. So, some worldly person wants to enjoy the world. Funny thing here is, who is the enjoyer? Body. You know, who eats your rasagulla, your mind or your body? The rasagulla is made up of what? Three gunas. Your body is made up of what? Three gunas. So, three gunas are eating.
Three gunas.
And you are thinking, I am so happy I am eating. That illusion in his kartrutva means, I am the doer, I am the knower, I am the desirer, and I am the enjoyer. That feeling is called ahambhava. But that ahambhava is also part of the three gunas only. Because there is nothing, here is God, here are three gunas. And all these things do not belong to God. Therefore, the whole thing, the enjoyer is Prakriti, the enjoyed is Prakriti. That is what Bhagavad Gita, guna guneshu vartanta iti matva na sajjate. A knower, a wise person knows, gunas are interacting with gunas. I cannot unfortunately translate this word gunas into English language, because in English you have to translate it as qualities. The moment I say quality, it means it is white, black, and excellent, not so excellent, good, evil. That is not the very constitution of everything is gunas. You have to understand that much. Within that, there is so much different. This is good. That means sattva guna is more. This is mediocre. Rajoguna is more prominent. This is not at all good. That means tamoguna is very prominent. The whole universe, your body, your mind, your enjoyment, your suffering, everything is done. Prakriti is dealing with itself, enjoying. What have I got with Prakriti? Because I am pure consciousness. That is the knowledge we want. But at the moment, we are unable to separate ourselves because I am identified with my body and mind. That is called bondage. And body and mind are called limitations. Swami Vivekananda gives a beautiful example. Just imagine, you are in good health, you are very hungry, you have got first-class sweets and other food material, you enjoy it thoroughly, is it not? Imagine, if you have got two bodies, how much more you can enjoy similar bodies? If you have got 100 bodies, will your enjoyment increase or not? 100 times. The whole, all the jivas, living creatures, if that is you, will you enjoy or not? Tell me. But there is a problem there. Enjoyment is okay. But if anybody suffers, you will also suffer. Does a wise man suffer like that? No, he doesn't suffer. Because he doesn't also enjoy. He says, guna guneshu vartante. Gunas are working with gunas. I have nothing to do. Why? Then what does he gain? Because he is Ananda Swarupa. Another important point is, whenever we are enjoying something, we are enjoying our own Ananda, but manifested through that object. I want to discuss this particular subject. Whenever we are enjoying any object in this world, and apropos, you have to also proxy it and say, when you are suffering also, same thing. You are enjoying a sweetmeat, and you think that enjoyment or happiness comes out of the object. Is happiness or unhappiness an inherent nature of any object in this world? Intellectually we know, but experientially we don't know. That is our problem. We think that unless I eat sweetmeat, I don't get happiness. How do we know? Because if something is the nature of some object, then you can never separate it. If happiness is the nature of rasagulla, it must give happiness to every creature, because a sugar is sweet for every creature at all times, is it not? Salt is salt for every creature all times. Bitter is bitter for all creatures all times. It doesn't change 14 billions before. It is not going to change 14 billions. Is it correct? Does the same object give you the same enjoyment all the time? It differs from person to person. It differs from time to time. Differs from place to place, and it differs from in the same person from one condition to another person. If you are healthy, you enjoy something. If you are not healthy, you don't enjoy. The same thing applies to the other side also. If dukkha or unhappiness is the nature of a thing, it should always give dukkha to everybody. That is also not there. Now, what is the conclusion? Whenever we enjoy something, actually we are projecting our enjoyment onto the object. This is the truth. But we are not able to understand it because of maya. We think we are getting it. But who is a wise person? He understands it. My nature is happiness. At this moment, I don't know. But scriptures tell me that according to dharma, punya, I derive happiness from outside objects, external objects. But the problem with this is, if my idea changes, my enjoyment also changes. If you love somebody, you get so much happiness. The moment, for whatever reason, you hate that person, whatever is related, not only you don't get any happiness from that person, but whatever is related to that person also, you don't enjoy. Is it not a fact? That person's child, that person's house, that person's car, that person's dog, everything brings unhappiness, isn't it? And temporarily also it happens. That is why when you get angry with somebody and that somebody is not nearby or not possible, you will take something belonging to that somebody and try to break it and throw it out, etc. There was one poor boy, young man, and he was always dreaming about red Ferrari car. But he is in no way to buy even an ordinary third class car. And that doesn't prevent us from dreaming about it, you know, imagining about it. One night he had dreamt that he obtained such a car for $1 in America. So he got up and told his mother that this is what happened. And that lady said, "You are dreaming too much. Get on with your job," which was newspaper distribution. So he went that day, early morning, you know, early morning before other people wake up, they throw like that. So he went there, in one street, there is a big board, "This red Ferrari is for $1. He could not believe his eyes. He knocked at the door and one lady came out and said, "What is this? Is it true or are you joking?" He said, "No, it is not a joke. You give me $1, immediately it is yours." He could not believe. He gave $1, got the car, drove it back. His mother was shocked, you can understand. For $1, he dreamt it, he went, he got it. Then what happened? This lady, few days before, she had terrible quarrel with her husband. This car belonged, her husband was very fond of this car. And that night she decided that I will make him miserable by selling this car for $1. And she put up just previous night, nobody had seen or nobody will believe it. And this fellow was the person who went there. Really happened. There is some program called Believe It or Not. Fact or Fiction. In that, he shows 4 or 5 episodes like this and then asks the audience, find out which is fact and which is a fiction. Because they all look alike. And then in the end he will tell which is a fact and which is a fiction. This happened in 1935 or 45, something like that, in this place to these people. He will give the... If it is fiction, he will tell it is just created to confuse you. The point is, if we love somebody, then everything changes about that somebody. If we hate somebody, everything changes. Is it right? So, what is our point? What are we discussing? If happiness or unhappiness belongs to one object, it should be always there, unchanging, because that is its nature. But that is not true. With the same object can give us happiness, unhappiness in varying degrees, depending upon the time of the day, etc., etc., etc. There is no happiness. But then, if there is no happiness in the object, and I am getting happiness or unhappiness, where from is it coming? Then you have to say, unhappiness is coming from that object? No. It is coming from me. That means what? If I manifest my inherent happiness through the help of this object, then that happiness I am thinking it is coming through that. If the same thing, I don't get happiness through this object, then I am projecting my own manifestation of unhappiness. The point is, the happiness lies within me. My mind makes the obstruction and either manifests it as happiness or unhappiness. What is the teaching? Remove the mind. Then you will always be happy only, because that is your inherent nature. Now, this teaching is difficult to believe. That's why we must have faith in the scriptures. What is the definition of Brahman? Satyam, Jnanam, Anantam, Brahma. Satyam means existence, Jnanam means consciousness, and Ananta means Ananda. Anandam is the inherent nature of every soul, Atman. But when it comes in touch with the filters called mind and body, then the body is well, one type of result. If the mind is well, one type of result. If the body, mind are ill, another type of result. And varying degrees. That is the point. In this verse, what is the Lord saying? Nistraigunya Vishaya Veda, Nistraigunyo Bhavarjuna, Nidvando, Nityata Satvasto, Niriyoga Kshema Atmavan. Let me translate it. The whole world is consisting of three qualities. Traigunya Vishaya. So whether it is your body, mind, whether it is any object in this world, that means your body, your mind, anybody's body, mind, mosquito's body, mind, anything, it is all consisting of three gunas. Our mind also is consisting of three gunas. So you don't get anything from the three gunas. They have no inherent sattva, that means existence, inherent consciousness, or inherent ananda. But they are media through which the soul's ananda is reflected back. Simplest example, if you want to know, suppose you have a dirty mirror. How does your image appear to you? Isn't it? The more you go on cleaning it, the more clearer your picture becomes. Three gunas consisting of the mind, you imagine as a mirror. Because it is the mind is the mirror through which we have self-knowledge, idea. Is the point clear? You think you have an idea about yourself. How do you get that idea? Through your mind. The mind becomes a mirror. Here is another important point. When we say mirror, then this mirror need not be only, main mirror is our mind. But the whole world is another mirror. That means society. What you think society is thinking about you, that becomes your starting point. That's why if I put my hair like that, the society will approve. If I put cactus hair, then the society, all young ladies will be googly-eyed, not thinking that they are in a state of shock, etc. This is how we are moving from one social idea to another social idea. We want to get the approval of society. But if you want to be spiritual aspirant, don't ask for approval of society. You can only ask one approval. What is it? God. God, do you approve of me? He says he doesn't see all these things. What he sees is only your qualities, 35 qualities. Are you a devotee? Then these are the qualities. If God says, yes, you are my devotee. How does God say you are my devotee? You know how he says? He bestows his grace. The moment he knows, this is my child, immediately, you know what he says? I bestow my grace. How does he bestow his grace? Buddhi yogam dadamyaham. I enlighten their intelligence. That means what? We have correct understanding. The whole world is nothing but a temporary manifestation of God only. Then he starts looking upon the world not as world, but as God. That is called Jivan Mukta's Lakshana, a living free. Now you understand? No society can give freedom to give opinions, say you are looking beautiful, you are ugly person. These are all their opinions. I am not saying you should completely neglect. What I am saying is, so long as you are in society, be decent. Your only outlook will be, will the Lord approve of me? Am I fit? Then what happens to you? I am pleased with you. You will come to me. Otherwise, rebirth. You have to learn that lesson. That is the point. So the Lord, Nitraigunya Vishaya Veda. The whole universe is consisting of what? Three gunas. Then he said, Nistraigunyo Bhavarjuna. You go beyond the three gunas. What does that mean in simple words? It means you don't think you are the body-mind. It is good to say that I have a body-mind, not to say I am the body-mind. You say, I have a house. Fine. I have somebody, I have a child, I have a husband, I have a wife, that's all fine. But don't say, I am that. Otherwise, you lose them. Anyway, you lose them. Whatever is not yours, it will go away. So this is the first step. The second step will be, there is no body, there is no mind, it is all manifestation of God. If I put on these specs, I see God with name and form. If I remove these specs, what is the perspective now? Avidya. Then I see. If I remove these specs, I see the truth as it is, which is nothing but God. That should be our goal. So, Nistrai Gunyo Bhavarjuna. Go beyond the three gunas. How to go? First is Nirdvandvaha. Means go beyond dualities. What does it mean? Go beyond dualities. Means what? In this world, everything is consisting of dualities. Good, evil, life, death, light, darkness, happiness, unhappiness, gain and loss, victory and defeat. Show me one thing which doesn't have its opposite. Man, woman, black, white, good, evil, is it not? So what does it mean, go beyond? We every day we are going beyond in deep sleep, but there is no knowledge. So what it means is, accept things as they are. Do not allow your mind to be agitated too much. This is what Zen Buddhism specially teaches. Beautiful sayings are there. One student asked the Zen master, what is the cause of your happiness? You are always happy. Simple words. Says, when it is winter, I say it is winter. When it is summer, I say it is summer. What does that mean? Just, okay, it will summer, do you expect cold? Or in winter season, you expect Madras weather, Chennai weather? Don't expect. So there could be some unhappiness. If you are in a mosquito-ridden place, what do you think that mosquitoes will attack everybody, excepting you, because you are a holy person? You may think you are a holy person. The mosquitoes never think you are a holy person. You know whom the mosquitoes think you are a holy person? A mosquito Arjuna is requested mosquito Krishna. How do I recognize a holy human being? Oh Arjuna, you are my dear devotee, so I open this secret only to you. That fellow who has a new mosquito curtain without any holes is the worst of human beings. Higher than that is a human being who has got an old mosquito net, but here and there are holes where you can enter freely and come out. A few holes. He's just a holy man, ordinary holy man. But that human being who doesn't have any mosquito curtain is the holiest. This is how you recognize who is holy, who is holiest. Arjuna said, from now onwards I know, I am enlightened. Nasto moha. But the point here, Nirdvandvaha means accept situations accordingly. Now how do we accept also? Because smaller things we accept. But when it goes beyond certain limit, and that limit is purely individual. Some people have long limit, and some people have got very short fuse, what we call. There also, we have to slowly say, okay, I must have deserved it. I must have deserved it. Only yesterday I was reading Ramana Maharshi's one incident. It is written in the Arunachala Mahatmya that Arunagiri Shiva, he lives on the Arunachala mountain under a huge banyan tree whose leaves are very big. You know, usually banyan tree leaves are this and they make leaf plate with that. But this one will be, one leaf is sufficient for a person to eat, like a dinner plate. So one day Ramana Maharshi said, I was walking, suddenly a leaf blew and I saw it. I knew that this is the description, because he read these things. Then he said, I must see that tree. So slowly he went, there was no path. So he started climbing. And then from a distance he said, I saw that huge tree, and then with huge banyan tree. Then he said, I wanted to go near. What happened? His left knee accidentally touched something, a bush. And there were ferocious wasps and they started biting. Then he understood, it is not the will of the Lord that I should go anywhere near. And that is why wasps are biting, not because of anything, but the Lord doesn't want me to go. You know what he did? He kept his leg there saying, you committed the crime, you experienced the punishment. They went and stung him ferociously hereabout. Then later on he said, they did not sting anywhere else, any other part of the body, excepting the left leg. And he allowed them to sting him as long as they wanted. Then they went back, and then he said, with great pain, I crossed somewhere and ultimately reached some place, not his place. Then they gave him some milk, etc., and it took 2-3 days. The next day somebody found out, like a nail, each of that sting, you know, it just leaves, and he had to pick it out. Now, what is my point? He understood he committed a crime, and he said, I deserved the punishment. What would we do in that place? We blame everybody. I came to see you, and this is what happened to me, and either you don't exist, or you better not exist. If this is what you are, then there is no point in your existence. Now you see what has happened. So many things come in our life, and we cannot causally relate to anything that is there. Our problem is, we want to relate everything to the knowledge we already have. Simple example, today morning you have eaten something, and stomach ache started, and immediately what is your nature? Today morning, what did I eat to cause? Maybe 10 days before you ate something, that result is coming now, but we have forgotten about that. If this is the case, how do we relate our karmic effects to many, many, many past lives? We don't know. That is why the scripture has to be believed in. This is what Hindus are supposed to believe, because the scripture is telling whatever happens in each one of our life, jati, ayu and bhoga, all this is the result of karma. Understand? Jati means in which species, ayu means how long are we going to live, and bhoga means what type of experiences, happy or unhappy, it is fixed. Physically we can't change it, but mentally by accepting we can reduce the intensity, that is the possible to some extent. It is a different discussion. What I wanted to emphasize is, this is how we accept the dvandvas, means dualities, heat, cold, happiness, unhappiness, etc. And second, nitya sattvastho. In order to become fit to bear these normal day-to-day experiences without losing balance of our mind, to keep it under certain balance, then we have to develop a particular quality called sattvastha, sattvaguna. What does sattvaguna mean? You have faith in God, you do every day puja, japa, etc. And above all, you pray. What do you pray? Oh Lord, give me the ability to bear what cannot be changed. Give me the understanding and power to change what can be changed. And give me the ability to bear, to put up with what cannot be changed. That prayer helps us a lot. That is called nitya sattvastaha. Always think about God. Eat sattvika food. Do sattvika actions. Develop that sattvika mentality. In simple words, spiritual mentality. Then only you will be able to bear the dualities. Then, niriyogakshema atmavan. Niriyogakshema and atmavan. Atmavan means what? Be centered in God. Think always about God. If I tell you, think about the self, that is the correct meaning. But we can't understand what the self is. But we can have some idea, as I mentioned in this earlier, that all the descriptions, definitions given of Atman is never born, never dead, etc. Difficult to understand abstractedly. But if you apply it to God, instantaneously it becomes understandable, isn't it? Narayana doesn't have birth, doesn't have death, and he never changes, etc., etc. Now, apply Atmavan Bhava. Means what? Always be centered in God. Think of God, talk about God, read about God, and whatever you do, some way keep the mind on God. That is the meaning. Then he says, Niryoga Kshema. Yoga and Kshema are very special words used in Bhagavad Gita. Yoga means things necessary for our conducting life, not Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga. Kshema means preserving, protecting those things which we need to get. For example, you need some money and then you protect that money. Now, so long as you don't depend upon God, you have to do it yourself. But the moment you give the burden, offer the burden to God, now who will look after? God will look after. That is what he says. Nityavyuktanam yoga kshemam vahamyaham. God will do. But we must leave totally to God. Then only he will do it. These are the strategies or upayas for what? To go beyond the three gunas. In other words, depend upon God, think of God, be centered in God. He will do whatever is necessary for your life. But it doesn't mean now we go back and start becoming Atmavan. Not possible. Slowly we have to develop. We have to pray. We have to say, oh Lord, I am still a very ignorant person. Please bestow your grace and give that understanding by which I can conduct my life. That is the meaning of Gayatri Mantra. Truly, Gayatri Mantra has got three parts. The first part is, I want to have knowledge of the Lord. First part. Second part is, to get the knowledge about God, I meditate upon God. And the third part is, O Lord, you grant me that understanding so that I can have knowledge of you. Who can give God knowledge? Only God can give. We can never get it. You just now look at Tat Savitur Varenyam. Dhiyo Yonaha Prachodayat. Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi Dhiyo Yonaha Prachodayat. I will give another. Katyayanaya Vidmahe Kanyakumari Dhimahi Tanno Durgihi Prachodayat. Or Gadadharaya Vidmahe Ramakrishnaya Dhimahi Tanno Hamsaha Prachodayat. This is Ramakrishna Gayatri. What is it? Gadadharaya Vidmahe. We would like to know the nature of Gadadhara. Means Ramakrishna. How am I going to get that knowledge? Ramakrishnaya Dhimahi. Dhimahi means we meditate, think of Ramakrishna. Ramakrishnaya Dhimahi. Tanno Hamsaha Prachodayat. Let that Hamsa. Hamsa means what? Ramakrishna. Paramahamsa. That Hamsa means that Divine Lord, may He give me that understanding that who He is. When I know who God is, will I know who I am or not? When I know who I am, will I know who God is or not? Both ways, because there is no difference between these two. And this word Hamsa is a very beautiful word. It is a reversal of soham. You don't know that? There is something called, according to Hinduism, ajapa japa. Japa which is going on 24 hours in each living creature unconsciously. We have to make it conscious. What is that ajapa japa? Soham. So this is how it goes. Every breath has got two parts. When we say this person is breathing, it has two parts. One is breathing in, another is breathing out. Now observe what I do. So goes in. Hum comes out. So hum, so hum, so hum, so hum, so hum saha. In Sanskrit, hum so becomes hum saha. Visarga becomes okara. Hum saha. This, what is the reversal of hum saha? So hum, I am he. This japa is going on continuously. When we become knowledgeable people, this becomes conscious japa. That means I know who I am. In whatever way you interpret, I am pure consciousness. Small pure consciousness or huge pure consciousness. These are all academic discussions. This is what he says. Go beyond the three gunas. This is the meaning of this verse. That means go beyond world. That means go beyond your body and mind. When you go beyond the body and mind, then only one thing remains. The pure consciousness alone remains, nothing else. That is the goal. How to attain it? Nirdvandvaha nityasattvasto niriyogakshema atmavan. 4. First nirdvandva. There all experiences in life and every experience in life consists of these dualities. Either I am happy or I am not happy. I am well or I am not well. Isn't it? I am alive or I am dead. Yes, because according to Hinduism, death is only, I don't say, because this through this body, but the mind knows how to attain, how to bear all this and happily, not somehow with gritted teeth. Bear happily because this is a leela of God. How to do it? 3 qualities need to be developed. What is it? Nitya sattvastaha, develop sattva guna, which is described in the 17th and 14th, 17th and part of beginning of 18th chapter very thoroughly. Food and our worship and whatever we do, we can do as a sattva guna, as a rajoguna guni or tamoguni. Beautifully he is describing. The second is niriyoga kshema. Don't depend upon yourself because anything can happen. But then whom do you depend upon? Only upon God. He says, nitya sattvastaha niriyoga kshemaha atmavan. These are the 3 strategies given. If we observe this, you don't need the rest of the Gita teaching. This is more than enough. This is a wonderful teaching. We will stop here. Om Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kamsa Chanura Mardhanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagat Gurum.